As you know, our topic tonight is traffic safety. It is one of those issues that we receive the most calls about. It is one of those big concerns because it not only happens on our major thoroughfares, but it happens in front of your home, and it happens in front of our schools, and it has to do with the safety of every single person in our community. And there are a lot of factors that come into how we set speeds, how we design our roadways, and how we go about enforcing. So tonight we're going to cover quite a variety of topics, and we have a lot of experts in the room tonight to answer any questions. I will remind you that we will try to take questions at the end, just to make sure we can get through the entire presentation. If you have something specific about your house, your street, something that's particular happening, feel free to fill out the card or ask us afterwards. We'd like to try to make sure that we cover the broad topics tonight, but we definitely are concerned about your individual issues in your neighborhood. Tonight, to start off, I'm going to introduce Tim James, our Director of Public Works. He's been with the city for about 5 years, 4 years now, and he's going to talk about how we go about deciding what size streets we have, what kind of speeds we have, and why we put signs out. So welcome, Tim James.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity being here this evening again. In Public Works, we have the traffic engineering. So we're the engineering side of traffic safety. And I want to kind of go over a few things with you. But first, I have a quick question here for you. If you'd watch the video. This is a routine occurrence that we see all over town. So now, how fast was that vehicle going? So you get a chance to use your polling capabilities right now. Still moving a little bit. All right, looks like we've kind of... Okay, now I think we've kind of settled in. The correct answer for that vehicle was going 30 miles an hour. And that's one of the things that we see a lot of times when you're standing there watching vehicles go by. It's very difficult for us to gauge really what that speed is. Okay, let's get it off of that. So, why do we use the traffic control mechanisms that we use in the engineering for the city? The two big reasons that we use traffic control are for safety, so we can make sure that the people driving down the roadways travel safely, as well as for mobility, to make sure that for the roads that we want people to drive faster and to move cars through town, that they're able to do that while doing it safely also. So there's two reasons that we do that. And we accomplish that in several different ways. The first way is with our roadway design. So anytime we design a street, roadway, we have a lot of different aspects that we consider. A lot of research has gone into traffic, how people drive, and it really kind of boils down to people drive at their comfort level. And that's what they've studied through time, is how will people react to certain roadway designs that makes them comfortable to drive those speeds. And this is very important throughout everything that we're going to talk about, is driving at that comfort level. We also use speed limits. Once we've determined what's the safest way to drive and what's people's comfort level for a roadway, then we establish those speed limits to make sure that that's the safest speed for people to drive, and so they'll stay at that. Now, we say most people again, because there are those outliers who drive a little bit faster than the rest of us are comfortable, and that happens. That's one of the gentleman in blue here, but we do establish those speed limits so everybody knows what that safe speed is going to be for any particular roadway. We also use signage for many different reasons. One, to let people know what those conditions are on the roadway, as well as when you need to stop, yield, which directions you need to go for. And so we use signs for a lot of different purposes as you travel any of the roadways. And we also put up traffic signals. Once again, these are used to make intersections or larger volume intersections safe and to increase the mobility through those areas. If it was just a stop sign, you've been through those locations where when they go all red and it's a stop condition, it slows things down. So it increases our mobility through the city. Let's talk a little bit about speed limits. We get this question a lot regarding speed limits, people wanting us to slow them down or raise them up. So how do we establish those speed limits? The first thing that I want to talk about is it's called the prima facie speed. For an urban city like us, the prima facie, the basic speed that's allowable is 30 miles an hour. So if you don't see a sign on a roadway, by state law, it's the 30 miles an hour. We also have the ability, and you've seen a lot of our residential streets in town posted at 25 miles an hour. And we're able to do that for streets, but they have to meet a certain criteria. And that means they can't be any wider than 35 feet. We're not restricting parking on those sides of the road. Have to be in urban corridors, less than four lanes. So there's a lot of things that we have to look at before we can do that. But we've done that for a lot of our residential roadways. And this is the lowest that we can set a normal speed limit, at 25 miles an hour. And we've done that for a lot of streets throughout the city. For all the other streets, we do either through our design or speed studies is how we set that speed limit. Once again, it's determining what's that comfort, what's that safe speed for people to travel down any particular roadway. So speed studies, how we go about conducting a speed study, we have a couple different ways that we collect data. That's the first step. We have the radar trailers. We had one out here on Galloway as you were coming in. Did we get pictures of the license plates of the people who drove over 30? They don't do that, really. But that's one of the way we collect data. The other way is, in the other photo, you see it's a speed counter. Used to, you'd see the tubes that we put across the road. Well, we don't have those anymore. A lot of times when we say we did a speed study, people say, oh, I didn't see the tubes on the road, so you weren't out here. The other photo is how we do it. They're data collectors now that they can stall flat on the roadway, so you don't even really notice them that much, and they collect the data as vehicles drive over the top of them. We have one up here, so you can actually see the size of it. So when it's out there, sometimes it doesn't look any more than like we patched a pothole in that area. So now if you see some of these on the road, you'll know what it is and that we're actually out there collecting the data. So the piece that collects the data fits underneath the patch, so it's protected while it's in the field. Once we get that data, what we use it for is to produce a study. We look at all the data and figure out what is that speed that people are most comfortable driving down any particular roadway, and then that's how, by state law, we have to set the speeds. So when we get the information, if you plot it on a graph, it would look very much like this for any typical roadway. And it's based on that reasonable driver, that comfort level where everybody's going to drive the safe speed. Once again, you have your outliers. We all know those people who do that, or, you know, they're late for practice or something, but it's that normal comfort level. And that's based on safety. And it's the 85th percentile, which what that means is 85% of the speeds that came through that area are at or below that speed. So, once again, that's the safest speed. That's the most comfortable speed for the majority of our drivers. To travel that particular roadway. It's based on that particular roadway. And we use this information to establish that speed limit for that roadway. I want to talk a little bit about our signage and our signals. Once again, we get a lot of requests for, can I have a stop sign? Can we put up a traffic signal? There's a lot of criteria that we have to use to justify any of those locations. When signs or signals are put in the correct places, they really improve our safety and our traffic. However, if they're put in the wrong places, they can sometimes make it a lot more dangerous. If we put up a stop sign in the middle of a roadway, mid-block, that people aren't used to it being there, then what they'll do is they'll tend to ignore it, and it creates an even more hazardous situation. A pedestrian might be coming through there thinking, well, there's a stop sign, they're supposed to stop, but the driver's think, well, why is it here? So they'll roll through it, and that's when we can create hazardous situations. So that criteria is there for very good reasons to make sure it's put in the appropriate locations and it's safe. Now I apologize, I'm kind of fighting a cold here. The criteria that we use, it's included in the Texas Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices. There's a big book over here that has all the information that we have to go by when we place our signs and signals in a city. So we don't get to make this stuff up. This is consistent. That's how come when you go to city, the signs, the signals, all those things are very similar, so that when you're driving in Texas especially, and there's even federal regulations, that it's very consistent. So in the United States, people can go community to community and feel comfortable driving in all the locations. And that has criteria for us to put those. It has minimum volumes, what needs to be there. They're called warrants. If you hear say we need to do a warrant study, it's not a warrant like we're going to come arrest you. It's a warrant that we have to justify a sign or a signal being placed at a location. So we go out and we do another study. We count vehicles going through the intersections at different locations and determine, does it meet any of the criteria that justify a sign, stop sign, or a signal at that location? And so once we've done that, if it warrants that installation, then that's when we go ahead and put those in. If it doesn't, however, then we can't put one up at that location. And that's not the safest thing for us to do at that time. As far as the signage goes, we have two kinds of signs. If you look at the pictures, we have the stop sign and the one-way sign. Those are regulatory signs. Those are ones that are telling you to do something in particular. Speed limits, stop signs, yield signs. Those are regulatory signs. So they regulate something that's happening on the roadway. The yellow ones are what we call advisory signs. Those are telling you something's ahead. It's giving you advance notification for railroad crossings. The one with the signal head, there's a traffic signal coming up. The other one's two-way traffic. So they're just letting drivers know to try to make it safer, a condition ahead that you're going to face. Another big topic that we get to discuss quite often is traffic calming. Now, once again, we've talked about driver comfort level. So what traffic calming is, they are ways that we design features in a roadway to reduce that comfort level so people slow down. So that's what we try to accomplish with any traffic calming device or roadway design, is those features that make people want to drive slower. When we design interstate highways, the lanes are wide. There's very few barriers to the outside. Those are all the things that, and the roads are very straight. Those are the things that make you want to drive faster, that give you the comfort to drive faster. When roads are narrower, when they have turns in them, when there's medians, when there's lots of driveways, all those things make people want to slow down. When you drive, think about it. You know, if you're tight in a parking lot or something, you're going to drive slower. Those are those things that we just naturally do. Well, that's what traffic calming is. Those are those features that make people want to drive slower. If you look at the top picture, this is just one of our residential streets. When we have parking on both sides and two cars can't hardly pass in the middle, people slow down because you're not comfortable driving very fast. Once again, most people. We still have those that exceed it, but most people. With that, we get a lot of requests for speed bumps. Now, speed bumps is a very interesting topic. Actually, in the city, several years ago, they did a study. We put in speed bumps, and it was very interesting. We found that speeds actually increased when we put the speed bumps in, because people would slow down, go over them, and they'd speed up to get to the next one. And so they are actually not effective at what people wanted them to do. There's a lot of drawbacks with speed bumps. That's why we don't use them. When you're trying to make drivers slow down, well, same thing that happens to emergency services. Police can't get to your house as fast. Fire can't get to your house as fast. If you can imagine, if you're in an accident riding in the back of an ambulance and have to go over a speed bump, it's not something that we would really want to do. They also cause noise. You know, we get complaints sometimes about, you know, potholes, you know, people hearing that noise wanting us to fill it in. Well, same thing with the speed bumps. And then if people aren't paying attention, they can actually cause them to kind of veer off. So there is a hazard in neighborhoods with speed bumps causing accidents, people to go off the road. So there's many reasons we don't use speed bumps as traffic control devices in Mesquite. And lastly, I wanted to visit with you a little bit about safety. This is one of the big things that we try to focus on in traffic engineering. We do a lot with the schools. Our kids are very important to us, so we do a lot of work. We have 32 school zones throughout the city. signs, flashing lights. We have a lot of things that we do to promote safety and keep those speeds low around schools. We work with the schools to have the crossing guards. We can do crossing guard studies, especially for elementary schools, to determine where we need to put them, how many kids are crossing, things like that to look for to make sure that we have safe areas. We also work with the school to look at studies on how they can improve the traffic flow through their school sites so they impact traffic as minimally as possible. Now, it's very hard because you got a lot of people in a short amount of time that go to schools, but we work with them to try to figure out the most efficient way to route people through the schools year in, year out. We also this year are doing a kind of a new program. We're putting in rapid flashing beacons. If you look in the lower corner, these are going in five locations, and these are at pedestrian crossings at the schools. And you see them in other communities. There's that real bright flashing light, so when there's a pedestrian going through there, they really catch the driver's attention to let you know there's a crosswalk at that location, and we're putting them around schools so people will know. It's just another way that we're trying to really improve the safety for our school kids. We've also passed the regulations with no cell phones in schools. Trying to keep people paying attention while they're going through when we have our kids. And lastly, one of the big things that we really try to do on the traffic engineering side is anytime there is an accident on the roadways, we always try to review those accident reports to see, is there anything that we could have done that would have improved the safety? You know, a sign, people didn't see it. Could they not see the signal? You know, what was it? Was it speed related? All those things that we look at, is there anything that we need to do at that location? You know, there's a lot of times that it's driver inattention or they might, you know, have had an accident for other reasons that it wouldn't have mattered if we had a sign there. But if there's any of those places that we could improve it, that's what we try to look at so we can make improvements on a continual basis throughout our city. So for traffic engineering, that's just kind of an overview of what we try to do and some of the features that we have out there. With that, I'll turn it over to Chief Cato.
Thank you, Tim. Good evening. We're going to get your phones ready. We're going to do another one of those poll questions here. What's the final result in more deaths in Mesquite each year, homicide or traffic accidents? Good. 108%? Okay, that's... You're real true believers then. Yeah. All right. That's right. Everybody was on point. The traffic accidents cause more deaths in Mesquite every year in and year out, than homicides do. If you look at the last 3 years, 14, 15, and 16, we've had 41 people die in motor vehicle collisions, and 15 people die as a result of homicide. Even in 2015, which was a high year for homicides in the city of Mesquite, normally we average four or five. That year there were nine, and still traffic accidents outpaced them. So 45% of traffic accident, traffic deaths are alcohol-related, and you're 2.6 times more likely to be killed in a traffic accident than to be murdered. So it's serious business out there. What we're talking about with the traffic engineering and the police enforcement side of it is to make the city a safer place. So what's the primary goal of traffic enforcement? I'm gonna wanna get your questions ready here, your phones ready, because there's a couple of questions. There's test questions about why do we write tickets? So what's the traffic citation quota established for each patrol officer per shift? One citation, three citations, or 10? Or none? I think we're settled in. It was a trick question. I mean, most of you got it. There's none. There's no quota. In fact, I would go to jail as a police chief if I set a quota for traffic citations. It's a violation of the law, and I don't want to break the law because I would not look good in an orange jumpsuit, okay? A short, round fellow like me would look like a Oompa Loompa, so I do not want to violate the law. There are no quotas. All right. Next question is, What percentage of Mesquite's annual budget is derived or obtained from traffic fines? What percentage there? It's like a race there, yeah. So people are changing their minds, it looks like, so. All right. This little yellow part here, and that's all fines, not just traffic fines. That's code enforcement fines, that's anything the fire department or building inspection writes. All citations and forfeitures are just under 3%. So if you got the 3%, you were correct. So we don't write citations. We don't write citations because we have quotas. We don't write citations to raise money to generate revenue. The reason we write citations is to influence driver behavior, to reduce injuries and death and property damage. We want to keep the city and the motoring public safe. And we're going to have someone else come up. And Chief Picchione.
Good evening. I just realized George came in that I'm going on my 34th year, and George taught me traffic enforcement in the academy. And he came in and sat in front of me, and I remember that, George, because the morning of the first class, you were late, and when we asked, you were involved in a traffic accident. So, probably didn't want me to mention that, but I'm going to. Okay, what I'm going to talk to you about today is injury accidents and fatalities. We have Sergeant Alexander here and Captain Yates. Captain Yates is captain over the patrol division. Sergeant Alexander is our sergeant over our traffic unit. Our traffic unit are the people you usually see out there on the highways writing tickets, and that's pretty much what they do, write tickets and enforce traffic laws in the city. They work all our accidents, our minor, and some of our minor, but most of our major accidents. We're going to talk first about injury accidents and fatalities. As you can see, we break our accidents down by non-highway and highway. We have a lot of accidents on non-highway, don't only include residential streets. As a matter of fact, most non-highway accidents are your major thoroughfares, such as Gus Thomason, Galloway Avenue. There's actually more accidents on those major streets than there are on our highways. But as you can see, our highway accidents are much more deadly, obviously because of the speed. Residential fatalities, we haven't had any. I can't remember when the last one was. School zone fatalities. I think the last one, John, was back in the 90s when we had a fatality in the school zone. So most of our fatalities occur on our highways, and some of them to a lesser degree occur on non-highways. The cost of these accidents, according to federal statistics on accident costs, we estimate to be about $11 million a year in the city of Mesquite. And if you notice here, there's a lot more injuries compared to the previous slide. We talked about injury accidents, but it's because we have multiple injuries in accidents. So the injury number is much, much higher. And this just includes property damage. This doesn't include time missed from work. It doesn't include insurance claims. It just includes damage done to properties, whether it's city or personal property. One of the things that we've really seen a rise in the last couple of years, obviously, with the advent of technology, is distracted driving. This has become one of the major causes of a lot of our accidents. Obviously, we all see, if you ever stopped in traffic and you look to your right or your left, you always see people putting on makeup or texting. It's a problem for us. It's a problem for everybody. It's a problem for police officers, because we have technology in our cars now, too. We have mobile data computers. When me and George started, we had a stick and a radio, and that was it. That was our technology. And the radio, you had to turn on and let it warm up. So if you got into a bad situation for the first 10 minutes of your call, you had to drive around the block because you couldn't call for help. But these days, we have all kinds of electronics in our cars. Citizens have electronics. It's very important. And here's just a few suggestions for stopping distracted driving. Adjust your car controls before you go. Don't be driving down the street trying to. If somebody else drives the car with you, don't be moving your seat forward. Try and do all that before you get in the car, because sometimes people move the seat back while they're driving. They can't touch the brake anymore, and they run in the car in front of them. Radio stations, some people are particular about the radio stations. If you want to change them before you're driving down the road. This is one that's hard for me to sit up here and tell you not to do. Stop, don't eat and drink. If you ever seen a police officer, more than once I see police officers going up down Galloway with a microphone in one hand and a burrito in the other. They went through the drive-through and they're going from call to call and they don't have time for lunch. It's not a good practice. If you can avoid eating or drinking while you're driving, you shouldn't be doing that. Stop your car to talk or text on the phone. It's another one that a lot of people do. It causes a lot of our accidents. Plan your route. With the advent of AVL, with Waze and Google Route, all these technologies that we have, people sometimes are driving down the road, and it's kind of ironic because Waze now, which is one of the big navigation software, it says you appear to be, are you driving a car? Because if you're not, give it to the passenger. I don't know how many people actually do that, but it's on there. But all you got to do is push the no button, and I don't know if there's some technology that they know you're not the passenger, but it is a navigation causes a lot of problems too. Don't multitask and stop your car to take care of your children. Another one, which is sometimes easier said than done, when you have a bunch of kids in the back fighting each other and you got to break it up. But sometimes parents are turned around taking care of their kids and they run into the car in front of them. There's three main components of traffic safety: speed enforcement, seatbelt enforcement, and DWI enforcement. We're going to talk about speed enforcement to start out with. We have three areas that we concentrate on with our speed enforcement. We have residential, non-highway, and we have highway and school zone. Okay, here's going to be your first poll. How many speeding tickets did the Mesquite Police Department write in 2016? Everybody locked in? Well, the answer was 9,702 tickets for speed enforcement. As you can see, we write more tickets on non-highways than we do on highways, even though the majority of the fatalities we have are on highways. So the question is, why would that happen? As with criminal enforcement of laws in the city, same applies to speeding enforcement. We always have to, there's two components to law enforcement. One is you have to have a safe city statistically, and secondly, people have to feel safe. If you don't have one of those, if you don't have both of those, it doesn't do you much good. We get a lot of our work orders from citizens, and obviously citizens don't call in and say, we need people out in 635. Most people call in and say, I need somebody on my street. We had 100 citizen-generated work order complaints last year that we worked. Now, that's just the formal complaints that we get. So if somebody calls in and says, I have a constant problem on this street or in this school zone, we will put officers out there for a couple days to work it. This does not include all the ones we get, people just calling into the watch commander at night and saying, hey, there's a kid down the street that goes by here at 5 o'clock every night, and we put somebody out there to try and catch him. These are the formal work orders that we document how many hours we went out there and how many tickets we wrote. And these are the locations around the city last year that we worked them. For 2015, we did 360 hours and 728 citations. And in 2016, we did 542 hours for 1,417 citations. Next, we'll talk about seatbelt laws. All occupants must obviously wear seatbelts, and seatbelts is something that has come a long way over the last couple of years. We have much more compliance today with seatbelts. Years ago, it was an uphill battle when the law first passed. We had a lot of seatbelt tickets. It was a took up a lot of our time writing seatbelt tickets. Today, most people, thankfully, wear seatbelts. A couple statistics: approximately 13,335 people were killed in 2016 while not wearing a seatbelt. Proper seatbelt usage reduces death or serious injury by 50%. Over half of all fatalities were not wearing a seatbelt. And the compliance rate, like I said, for seatbelt use now is estimated at 90%. That's really good. Okay, another poll if I make this one work. How many seatbelt tickets did the Mesquite Police Department write in 2016? Trying to pick out curtains with my wife. That's when I think she has it. Okay, we ready? Correct answer. It was 137. Seatbelt enforcement, like I said, thankfully, we work it. We get grants to work it. But most people comply with seatbelts. So that's good news. And DWI enforcement. Most people know what impaired driving is. If you're 21 years of age or older, it's 0.08. If you're a commercial driver, it's 0.04. And younger than 21 years of age, this is one that some people may not know, any detectable amount. You can be, it's a different violation. It's a Class C misdemeanor, but you can still be prosecuted for it. DWIs in the state of Texas between 2003 and 2012, there was 13,138 people killed in DWI crashes. Texas has a high DWI rate as compared to other states. Our next question, this one, if you're driving around the city, you probably already know this because we have it on all the billboards and bulletin boards when you're coming into the city, but how many DWI arrests did the Mesquite Police Department make in 2016? Okay, it's like the billboards are working. 701. It's a record for the Mesquite Police Department. We arrested more people in 2016 than we had in any other year. We kept records. Our fatality rate is on a downward trend. We ideally want that to be at zero, but this is a big part of our enforcement, DWI. There's still, unlike seatbelts, there's still a lot of them out there. Still a lot of people didn't get the message, and still a lot of people that need to go to jail, and this is something that we work very hard at. Some of the reasons that DWI deaths are down and our enforcement is up is our breath tests have been replaced by blood tests. We no longer have a breath test. Most departments do not have a breath test. We now take blood only. Blood is very hard for defense attorneys to fight. There's a lot of science behind blood tests, unlike the breath tests. There's a saying at district attorney office, if it bleeds, it pleads. If we get blood off of them, they usually plead out guilty because they know it's an uphill battle when you have blood. We have a no refusal policy, so you can no longer, like with the breath test, refuse to take a breath test. If you get arrested, we will get a warrant. We have a system set up with the judges where we fax the information to the judge's house, get the warrant signed. You know, whether it's 2, 3 o'clock in the morning, get it faxed back to us, and we go ahead and take you to the hospital, and we take a mandatory blood draw from you. And the last is public awareness, a little bit of what you saw out in the parking lot. We have our fatal vision, impaired driving, and our impaired driving simulator we have down in the lobby. That's part of our public awareness campaign. And we also work very closely with MAD every year. And what are some common sense things you can do to stop DWI? One is designate a driver. That's a very good idea if you're going out. Always have a designated. A lot of places have free soda or free non-alcoholic beverages for designated drivers, taxi or Uber. And the last one is always, if you see a drunk driver, you see somebody that thinks drunk, have somebody in your car, not you, while you're driving, because you'll be distracted. But have someone report that, even if you have to pull off the road. One of the, working as long as I have here, I've been involved in a lot of things, but one of the cases I'll never forget was when I was a relatively new officer in the early 80s. I came up on an accident where the woman had gone through the windshield, and she had a terrible slash down the side of her face. Her husband was trapped in the car. He had two broken legs, and they had just been married that morning. And we got him out and got him to the hospital, and I'll never forget one of the things he said to me is he said, I had all my family members there, and I was drunk, and none of them kept me from driving. None of them said no. And they all, he said, I wish somebody would have stopped me. He said, I wish you would have stopped me earlier. He said, I'd rather be in jail right now than be here. And I remember his wife of just a couple hours was in the emergency room getting stitched up, and she had a scar from here all the way down to here. It was wide open. And I was thinking to myself, these poor couples got to look at that for the rest of their lives, and that'll be the memory they have for their wedding and what happened. So it's real important. Don't take it for granted. If you see something, let us know. We have a lot of officers out there working, and this is a priority for us, and we will get on it. And with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Chief Cato.
Since DWI is enforcement is a priority, as Chief Picchione mentioned, we work with MAD, the Mothers Against Drunk Drivers, the Dallas County North in the North Texas chapter, and they recognize officers in our department every year for making the most arrests and for being a MAD hero, and they give recognition for them. They have a ceremony once a year, and it's important to us to so much that we participate in the Walk Like MAD event. It's a team walk, and it's a fundraiser for MAD. One of the things that they do at this that's very, very moving is that they ask the families of people killed with drunk drivers to bring a pair of shoes that belong to the deceased person. And you see all these rows of shoes out there that used to be people that are now gone because people made bad choices and drove while impaired. And it's personal for us in the Mesquite Police Department because the man on the left there, Dr. Gary Perdue, he was the chief of the burn section at UT Southwestern and worked at Parkland for 22 years. He's the father of one of our officers. He was on his way 7:30 in the morning to go make his morning rounds at the burn unit, and he was hit by a drunk driver and killed. And Megan Rao, she was at Texas Tech University. She's a daughter of one of our officers, a sergeant, Sergeant Kevin Rao, and she was killed by a drunk driver. So it's something that's not just some abstract thought. It is real. It is personal to us, and that's why we take it so serious.
Hi, I'm Firefighter Nick Steven, and this is Police Sergeant George Hensley.
Texans love to claim everything is bigger in Texas, and our state pride is no exception.
But leading the nation in drunk driving-related deaths is nothing to be proud of, and it's a record we don't want.
In 2015, almost 1,000 people lost their lives in Texas in an accident involving a drunk driver. 83 of those deaths were in Dallas County alone.
Those killed were more than just a number. They were mothers, fathers, daughters, and sons, and someone misses them terribly.
Drunk driving laws make it illegal to drive with a blood alcohol content at or above 0.08 nationwide.
And once impaired, time is the only remedy to sober up.
Before choosing to go out and drink, plan a safe way home, designate a sober driver, call a taxi, or use a ride-sharing service.
And if you see a dangerous driver, distance yourself immediately from the vehicle and call 911.
Help change the numbers. Help save lives and make Texas proud.
I want to compliment our police and fire department for putting together these public safety PSAs. This is our second one, and we hope you will be seeing more of these. This is kind of your introduction. You should see this on social media here starting this week. One of the other things that I'd like to share is that traffic safety is personal to all of us. We all have either children or grandchildren or just ourselves when we're out in our neighborhood, and the city staff takes it very personally as well. As you've seen the police department, traffic engineering, we truly care about creating a safe community. But there's only so much we can do when it comes to enforcement and engineering. We can put up all the signs. We can put out police officers every day to try to slow people down. But when it comes down to it, it does involve changing behaviors and getting the message out to the community. So as we close tonight's program, I'd like to share with you something that we are launching beginning next month. And it's called Drive Like Your Family Lives Here. And it's because of the concerns that we've heard from you and from our city council members who have heard from citizens that we needed to put together an ongoing targeted education program. We have our staff, our communications department, our police, and we've come up with this tagline to represent what our education component will be moving forward. And we kind of call it the three E's. This is the third component with engineering and enforcement. And it's an integration of our communications program along with our citizen engagement opportunities. We are going to try to reach out on all platforms at every occasion that we can to educate people about proper traffic safety. And it's going to focus on a variety of areas. Speeding in residential areas, speeding or proper use of crosswalks, driving in school zones, everywhere we can to educate people on the things that we hear on a regular basis. And we're not only going to target motorists, we're also going to target pedestrians as well, because before you step in the street, you are basically impacting safety for either a motorist or for yourself. We hope to kick this off, like I said, early in April, and what you will see are our monthly communication points, and either through social media. We will also be utilizing median signage that we have, you'll see on major intersections, but it'll also be social media, it'll be Crime Watch meetings, it'll be neighborhood meetings. We also plan to target, and really we want to reach every motorist and every parent in the community. So we will be putting flyers out at the beginning of the school year, talk about school safety, but also school zones and crosswalk safety as well. And basically, we want to make sure that, you know, we are very fortunate in Mesquite. Our traffic deaths are low when it comes to things that happen in our neighborhood, but we've just been lucky. Through many of us who've been here for a while know of children who have been hit just simply just walking in their neighborhood, inattentive to crossing the street. And each of those stories impacts all of us deeply. And so when we were tasked with coming up with something to make a point in our community and reach out to all of the citizens, we all took it pretty seriously. And I believe that this program will change behaviors, because we are going to hit everyone, like I said, either while you're driving, while you're at home, while you're on social media, or just going through your child's school packet. Well, this message will come across loud and clear. I want to invite anybody, I'll bring Chief Cato and Tim James back up, and we'd be happy to answer any questions at this time. You said you weren't shy. You said you were vocal, so feel free to ask a question. Yes, sir.
Mr. Jane, the rapid flashing beacons that you mentioned.
Yes, sir.
Will one of those be at the school crossing on Galloway above Hope Eaton High School?
Yes, that is one of the locations.
That is a vaguely not well seen school crossing.
Yes, and they. One of the challenges that we have, even especially with Poteet, is getting the kids to cross at the designated locations. But yes.
When they're there, if there's a big vehicle in the center lane, and you can't see the child, the kids.
Yes. Yeah. We have two at Horn, one at Poteet, one at Kimbrough, and then one at West Mesquite. Those are the five locations.
Greg Williams. Last Thursday, I was served on a jury down the hall. It was about a speeding ticket. And the person didn't deny the speeding. What he was questioning was the little, they call it something different than laser, but.
LIGO.
Okay, well, he started him at 47, 49, and he finished it at 50. And the guy was complaining that, you know, at 50, he wouldn't be able to take a course or the fine would go up or something. So he took it to court. It was nice, but I was just curious about the this device, how they do it.
We have a traffic sergeant. He's the technical expert on those things.
I kind of like to see y'all.
We had a demonstration outside.
The question of laser, basically what it's doing is shooting a light beam out. Well, that light beam reflects off the front of the vehicle. So if we depress the trigger and we hold that trigger, it'll continue giving us readings. So if your speed is going up or down, it'll continue giving us those readings until we release the trigger, and it'll lock the speed in. The radar that we used to use was a Doppler that would go out and reflect off a metal object. Now it's LIDAR. It's basically shooting a light wave, and it reflects off an object. The difference between radar and LIDAR is radar, when it goes out in a beam like a cone. So at 1,000 feet, you can pick up, you know, a good wide 100-foot area. And then LIDAR, at 1,000 feet, it's only about 3 foot wide. So it's got a scope on it. We look through the scope, but through a red dot we put on the front of vehicles. And that's how we can select vehicles one by one. And most of us, that when we're working enforcement, when we shoot a car, what we'll do is we'll keep on it to see if they're speeding up or if they're slowing down. And that might be why he testified in court that he got multiple speeds.
Well, it seemed like his argument, he could go 80 and still would complain because you started me at 47. And it's just because he went up to 50, what's the complaint?
The state of Texas allows you to take defensive driving unless you're 25 miles over the speed limit. If you're 25 over the speed limit, you can no longer take it.
I'm Sherry Williams, and I have two questions. How do you choose school zones that you monitor, and do you do it like, do you switch around with them or whatever? And also, what if you witness a school bus speeding through a school zone? What should you do?
If you witness a school bus speeding through a school zone, you should get the bus number. You should get the bus number and let us know. And since Mesquite ISD runs their own buses, it's not contracted out like a lot of school districts. We have contacts in the school district. We'll let them know when their drivers was speeding, was breaking the rules, and they take that very seriously. The safety of the children is a paramount, even and especially for the school district, because once they're on their bus, they're responsible for them, and their buses are just an extension of the school district themselves. The other question, I'm sorry. We usually do that through work orders. People complain about the schools. We know all the school zones are going to be an issue at some point, and I believe that we work them all just through the year. But those we are directing our efforts first as a priority, those where we have complaints or we know that there are violations, either from the school administration or from the neighbors, people who live in the neighborhood.
Hi, I'm Rose Grimsley. Thank you all for doing this for us. We appreciate it. My question is, on the west side of Mesquite, just past 635, where Military and Cyene cross each other, is there any plans to reroute that or do something with the traffic? Because if you're on the side and you have a green light and they're supposed to yield to you, they don't. If you're on the side where you yield, that you almost get rear-ended every time. I've gotten where I avoid that intersection. But that's just a question I have in general.
That part of the roadway is controlled by TxDOT, and based on the complaints that we received, we have requested TxDOT to continue to study that. It is a very complex roadway there, and but as we do with everything, we monitor traffic accidents. We look at all the different factors and. The same thing that TxDOT does when they study a roadway. That's the data they look at.
Can we as citizens put any pressure on TxDOT for you?
Yes, feel free to contact TxDOT directly. So, but we will continue to pass on the concerns. Anytime that you bring a concern up that's TxDOT related, we do pass that on with our contacts.
Yes, sir.
I have a question on North Mesquite's exiting at when school is getting out onto the service road. Is there any way you could put traffic cones out and block one lane so those cars can exit out and then remove them after the after school is out 20, 30 minutes after?
It's a nightmare.
Once again, that where you're talking about exiting onto the service road, mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a TxDOT roadway, so that's one of those things that they regulate, so we can't tell them what to do with their roadways. So we can pass that on to them. I know that's a concern in that area also. So that's once again, just like the cross there at 352, we will certainly pass on to them.
Can the school officers not come out and do something during that time? The SRO officers?
The traffic officers?
The school police officers could,
but the problem is that they've got so many kids at those schools mm-hmm. that they are busy inside with that school.
Yeah.
Because we've gotten complaints at different schools before that we go out and we ask the SROs and they're like, we're so tied up with stuff inside. You know, they got 600 to 2,000 kids in there that they're dealing with.
And
so we come out and deal with the traffic.
Are they responsible for the jaywalking outside too? Is that what those officers are responsible for writing those tickets? Because I know at one time it came out a campaign that y'all were going to start ticketing the jaywalkers at the schools, like going to Jack in the Box and not going to the red light on Town East.
Yeah,
the
reason we put the SROs really at the schools is for the safety of the students and the staff inside the school. Through nationwide all the way back to 1999 from the Columbine incident, we've learned our lesson that we need to have well-trained officers, well-versed of what's going on inside the school. We can do generate work orders for situations like that, and that's what we're talking about with those work orders, 100 we had last year. That's how we prefer to handle those with people outside the school, because the school district does reimburse the city for half the salary of all those officers, so we don't like to pull them out of things. Now, it is technically, I guess, a school thing because it's school kids doing it, but we prefer to keep them attached to the school and help maintain order in the school. And our schools are not out of control, because I think that's a reason. It's why we have good working relationship between the administrative staff at the schools and the SROs. And we have those situations like that, we will generate a work order and send some folks out there.
Any other questions? Yes, sir.
Well, this has come up three times. Who is a contact at TxDOT that is responsible for state maintained roads inside Mesquite?
Depending on which it is, you can always forward those to us. If it's a maintenance issue, if it's a traffic issue, there's several different points of contact. They have their main contact number. You can always go onto their websites and you can look at their district offices and go through that way. Or you can always send them to us and then we can forward it on to the contacts that we know about any of those. So we'd be certainly glad if you want to send them to us and we'll pass them on.
First off, if somebody sees them, you can contact TxDOT. But that is a huge place out there and you can easily get shuffled around because you don't know. There is somebody that's responsible for enforcement issues in state-maintained roads in Mesquite, but we never know who that is.
And sometimes it changes for us, too, so we have to continually update our contact list as well. So that's why you can forward to us, and we'll send them to the ones that we have most recently also.
Back in the back.
My name's Betty Banks. And I'm wondering why Beltline has multiple speeds.
Once again, the speeds that we set, when we go out and we take a study, so a lot of times through Beltline, it changes a little bit of the section. The number of driveways, some sections, especially by the high school, are a little tighter. So when we've done the speed studies, that's what the 85th percentile was. So we established the speed based on the studies. That allows us to set those speed limits. So even for the same roadway, it can vary. Traffic can affect it, driveways, things in the area. Once again, it's that driver comfort for a particular section of roadway. So that's how come through that corridor there are different speeds based on the studies we performed in the past.
Well, what I am seeing is people that are driving 35 miles an hour, and then you come up on a 40 mile an hour speed, say like right around where Walmart is, and people are going well over 40. I mean, zooming.
Yes, ma'am. So what we'll do is we'll get somebody to monitor that area. If you can get with me afterwards, one of the uniformed staff, and give us an idea of the block. I know Walmart. I know where that's at, obviously. We answer enough calls over that way. But, I mean, is it before Walmart? Is it after Walmart? Because there's two traffic-controlled intersections right there, one on Range and one on the service road. So they can't really speed through there because of the traffic control device. Is it before that? Is it after that? You know, north? That's what we need. If we get specific information, we can generate a work order.
Well, I see this on, like, the weekend, Saturday and Sunday, more than during the week. So it's, you know.
Yes, ma'am. So we'll get with you. We'll get some information. We'll get a work order generated.
Last question.
I'm the president of one of the crime watch groups, and I wanted to know who would we contact, because we have a meeting in May, and I'd like to have that presented to Drive Like Your Family this year.
Depending on what materials we have available and where we're at in the preparation, we'd be glad to do that. And we'll just, if you'll contact me,
okay,
and let me know the date, and we'll make sure to have somebody out there.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Well, if you would join me in giving a big hand to our staff who presented tonight. We appreciate their time and effort that they put in for the presentation and to help educate you tonight. With that, the staff's portion of the town hall is complete, and I'd like to invite Mayor Stan Pickett up to say a few words.
Thank you. I want to mention all the council members that are here tonight supporting your council members. We have Mayor Pro Tem Bruce Archer, Deputy Mayor Pro Tem Jeff Casper, Councilman Dan Alamon, Councilman Greg Noshe, who was, there he is right in the back, Councilman Bill Tarpley. Mr. Tarpley's not here, so Bill Porter, I guess that, yeah. Sorry. You know what, at least it wasn't a wife tonight, right? When you forget the wives' names, but that may be my M.O. from now on. I'm sure that, I know that council would like to say a few words, but I don't know if we have a lot of time to do that. Is there anything that you guys particularly wanted to mentioned tonight, I want to give you that opportunity.
Sure, Bruce, come on up.
Thank you, Mayor. I want to first thank all of our staff for putting this together, our Citizens Police Academy alumni. I need to apologize to Mr. Larson and to my colleague, Councilman Alamon, because I was really passing some judgment on their driving skills earlier as they were knocking down cone after cone out there, and had a good laugh until they put me in there, and I quickly realized those goggles were for impaired drivers, but I think I didn't hit as many cones as they did. But this is dear to my heart. I'm so proud of what our staff's put together for this. This is so important. Just like I'm sure my colleagues have, I've had so many requests and complaints and concerns voiced by constituents all over this city in the last few years about speeders flying by up and down residential streets, not just the commercial streets, but in neighborhoods. I've had senior citizens voice concerns about going out to their car and almost being hit because people just don't care. I have personally witnessed in places like on Hillcrest, which is a through street, on an afternoon, watch cars racing up and down there, or on Spring Lake over in Edgemont Park. And so, and many times our staff could tell you, I've passed on requests, and our traffic engineering department will go out and put up the digital speed trailer, and then our officers go out and write a bunch of tickets, and our staff does a great job, and it slows some folks down for a little bit. But then when those folks go to another location, those speeders just go right back to doing it again. So to Mr. Kahili's point earlier, there's just not enough enforcement or resources or manpower to provide enforcement the way we need to. It's just not there. So this has to become a public education, public service campaign, just like drugs were back in the 80s. And so I want to challenge all of you here and those who are watching tonight to please use your social media, Crime Watch meetings. Let's talk about these things. Talk to your kids at school. Get this out there. Let this become such a big deal in Mesquite to slow folks down and protect kids and families. So, again, I'm going to thank the staff for putting this together, and I thank you all for being here tonight to care about this issue. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you.
I just want to congratulate our Mesquite police. I wish that these drunk drivers were not out there, but to hear that they went after a record number of DWI citations, I want to congratulate them, because we need to go after them, and we know that that means less lives are lost out there. So thank you to the Mesquite Police Department.
Thank you. Anybody else? Okay. You know, one of the things, I'm sorry. Okay. Next time. What I really enjoy about coming to these things, several things come to mind, is seeing everybody and seeing your concern and seeing the fact that you're willing to come up and share with leadership. And I'm proud of our city, that they, our city leaders, that they're willing to be here and listen. But also, every time we have one of these meetings, I've heard every time, every question that you've asked, these guys, nobody says, well, I'll get back to you, or I'll tell you later, or I don't know. What they say is, what staff says is, I will take care of that for you. Call me. Call me tomorrow. Send me an email. I'm going to take care of that for you. So, staff, we thank you for being open and being available to our city. That's about it. It's y'all been here. CPA, great job tonight. Thank you very much for all that you've done, all that you do for our city. We're done? We're done. Thank you, guys.